Oh, I didn't mean outside. I just meant take her away, please. Hi, welcome back to another Colorful Keto with Dory. We will be joined in a moment by Dr. Ken Berry, and we're going to do our Motivational Monday question and answer. I'm super excited. We've got a lot of really, really great questions this week, some from Facebook and some from Instagram. So I'm super, super excited. As soon as Dr. Ken hops in, we're going to start with questions. Now, if you guys have any questions that you want answered, pop them in. We will try to scroll through the comments. I can't promise we can catch them today, but I will write them down after we see them on the replay. So I'm super, super excited. It's Monday. We're ready to start another week. We're super motivated. And we love talking to Dr. Ken on Mondays and getting all of our questions answered. Yay! Hi guys, I'm so excited to see you popping in. Now we're also available on Facebook. If you have any friends and family who are not able to watch it here with us on Instagram, they are more than welcome to check out my public page and go watch it there as well. Let's get Dr. Ken in. There we go. We're loading, loading. I touched up my hair today, guys. That's why it's still wet. I thought I was having a super quick shower while I was getting ready, and it turns out I was taking my time. Hello, Dr. Ken.
Hey, Dory. How's it going?
I'm lovely. How's your day? I'm going to turn you up just a little bit there.
It's been very busy, but very good.
Excellent. Yay.
I'm talking with my... talking with my keto girlfriends.
Yes. I always tell my guy they're my keto wives. And he's like, how come you get to have so many wives? I'm like, because I can handle that many wives. You can't handle that many wives.
That's right. You just couldn't handle it.
You can handle it. So we have tons of awesome questions today. Now, I sort of have a theme for the day because I've been getting a lot of the same question this week. And it's a good one, but it makes me giggle because it's a two-part question. And it goes like this. Hi, Dory. I know nothing about keto. How do I fast? So I want to talk about that. And I want to kind of talk about the different kinds of fasting, but why fasting isn't step one. If you're just learning about keto, I get it. We hear fasting is awesome. But I want to talk about if it's for beginners, when you would fast. So let's start with that. Should we be fat adapted before we start fasting?
Yeah, I think you should really get fat adapted before you start to fast in any meaningful way. I mean, we all fast when we sleep, right?
Yes.
And so if you want to start adding an hour or two to that, doing it 10 hour or 11, 12 hours even, I think that's perfectly safe and fine for anybody to do. Even if you're still eating the stupid American or the stupid Canadian diet, you can fast for 12 hours. That's not a big deal. But to go longer than that, it really helps so much to be fat adapted and to be eating a lot of good quality saturated fat. And here's why. The reason we eat fat on the ketogenic way of eating is because it hacks our hunger hormones, right? It tells our brain and our belly that we're full, and so we're not hungry. Now, you can imagine how much easier it would be to fast if you're not hungry.
Yes.
Right? And so get fat adapted, learn the keto ropes, and then you can, in just a few weeks, you can start blending in a 12 or a 14-hour daily fast if you want to do that. That's not necessary, but almost everyone finds that it works so much better. They're like the perfect marriage, ketogenic way of eating and intermittent fasting. There's no way to get healthier quicker than with those two, in my opinion.
Awesome. I love it. So now the question I get that follows that is, Dory, how do I know I'm fat adapted? And I tell them that's when you're not starving all the time. But is there a science-y reason, like a way that you would know, hey, now I'm fat adapted? Do we test for that? Well, do we pee on something, Dr. Ken?
Yeah, you can pee on something or you can check your blood. There's even a breathalyzer now that'll tell you if you have what level your ketones are.
Oh.
And for some people, they like to do that, and I think that I don't think it's dangerous or bad. I think it's expensive and unnecessary, because if you make sure that you're eating your macro percentages, and I don't care so much about the numbers, but as long as you hit your percentages, you're going to be in ketosis either today or shortly. And so when you're eating the ketogenic way, you really have no choice but to ultimately be in ketosis. And peeing on a stick will tell you if you have ketones in your urine, but as we've talked about before, Dory, that really, that's all it tells you, is that you have ketones in your urine. It doesn't tell you if it's because you're dehydrated or because you drank some exogenous ketones or if it's because you're truly in ketosis. And so any of those things can affect your ketone levels, and there are other things in the blood that can affect them as well. And so it's really, it's okay for beginners to play with that. Nisha and I did it for a week or two when we first started, but we quickly were like, yeah, this is dumb. I'm just going to eat the diet. And so that's what we did.
Okay, so then I got a really awesome question this morning, and it was kind of macros related and kind of not. She wanted to know why she was stalling, but I want to touch a little bit on the percent, because she just picked a macros tracker. It told her what to eat, and she was eating almost equal protein and fat, and she couldn't figure out why she wasn't losing weight. Like, her protein goal was 104 grams and her fat 116, and I was like, oh. She's like, but aren't I getting close to my numbers? I'm like, girl, you are right on your numbers, but your numbers are like whack.
Yeah, and so that's not dangerous to do, but it's going to slow down your weight loss so much to do that. And so the trackers are good for some people, especially people who are coming from the regular Canadian diet or American diet, and they don't have any clue how many grams of fat bacon has.
Yes.
Like, I can ask people two questions and I can quickly know if they're nutritionally savvy. So I ask them, okay, a strip of bacon, it has more fat, more protein, it's all fat, it's half and half. What would you guesstimate the macros for a strip of bacon? And
okay,
most people are going to say, oh, it's all fat. But actually, a strip of bacon is usually 1-to-1 fat
half
protein.
Half
and half, that's right. And so if anybody out there listening, if you knew that, then you're probably, you don't need a macro counter. You can probably just do it yourself. But if you were like, no, man, I thought bacon was all fat, then you don't know what's in food. And it's, I'm not being mean, I'm just saying you've got some learning to do, which is actually a great opportunity for you to get smarter and to become a local expert in the macros contained in food. And so that's a great opportunity for you to learn something, because bacon is half and half. It's 50% fat, 50% protein. And so if you're eating, if you're just living on bacon, you'd be a carnivore, and so you'd probably lose weight by doing that. But if you had bacon and then your 20 or 30 grams of carbs a day, you'd probably stall out. You probably wouldn't lose weight because it's 50-50.
Okay. Now, learning experiences, I just want to throw one in there quick. My son just started keto on the first of the month, so I've had an awesome opportunity teaching him how to... Yes, right? My 20-year-old. I'm so excited.
Nice. I can remember when he was in a video a few months back, he was like,
I know. And he was like, I'm never doing it, Mom. I'm never doing
That's
it.
Awesome.
I'm never
Excellent.
Doing it. But he decided. So I've got to teach him over the last few days how to add fat to everything. So when he had his salad, normally he would have ranch dressing. So he added 2 tablespoons of olive oil, flavored olive oil. And I've got to teach him ways to add fat. So I kind of want to touch on that. Because if you're trying to get your fat through your meat, is it ever going to work, percentage-wise?
It's hard. You have to buy super fatty meat to try to get there. But almost always you have to add fat to your meal just like you did. Let me tell you guys a tasty... Nisha's dad is Puerto Rican, hates vegetables. He is a meat and potatoes man, right? And he's definitely not keto. And the other night I had fried up some sausage, and I had a big bowl of spinach. And that's the first time I'd eaten vegetables in weeks. And so I took the sausage grease, which is basically bacon grease, and I poured it over all that spinach, and it wilted it, right? And then it soaked into the spinach. And then I put my sausage on top of that. I don't know if that has a name or not. I think I just made it up. But he actually tried some of the spinach. Like, he's never eaten anything green in his life. Nisha and her mom were both standing there going,
what?
Did he just eat something green? But he's like, hey,
that's green.
I ate that. And so, yeah, you put enough bacon grease on something that's green, I promise you'll like it. And you're going to, you know, make the fat content so much better and so much healthier.
For me, I eat a lot of fat for veggies. Like, because, you know, my small tummy, I'll cut up 3 Brussels sprouts and that gets me a tablespoon of bacon. And I'm like, don't judge me while I lick the bowl.
Absolutely.
So, we got a really great question off of Instagram today, and it's an interesting one, and I think it's something a lot of women come across. So it was this: when us women stall the week leading up to and the week after our Shark Week, is there any way to shorten the amount of that stall, or say break, or even prevent it?
Yeah,
I love it.
This is part of the reason that if a husband and wife start keto at the same time, he's going to lose more weight.
Yes.
So wives, don't be mad. It's not your fault. It's also not his fault. Men lose weight faster than women because we don't have those hormone and fluid fluctuations. It's not fair, but it's how it is. And so you got to cope with that. Two things that I would recommend is the week before and the week after is to try to up your fat even more and then maybe fast more.
Yes.
Right? Because fasting is wonderful for balancing hormones. And so I'm not saying that you're not still going to have a crappy week before Shark Week. And, you know, that's still going to happen. But it's going to be less severe, and you're going to have less fluid shift. Because remember, insulin is in charge of fluid, right?
Okay.
As far as holding fluids and stuff. And so many women, when they're having that terrible week, they mess up on their diet a little bit, which bumps their insulin, which makes them hold fluid. They just gain 2 pounds. It's just fluid, but still, when you're having that bad week and you get on the scale and the damn thing says you've gained 2 pounds, that makes that bad week even worse, right?
It does.
So you want to really up the fat, super low carb, and then maybe increase your fasting hours during the week before. It may not be fun, but it probably will make that week less severe and less gruesome.
And I recommend keeping some fat bombs or some cookies or some kind of treaties, some keto ice cream, you know, something just on hand that you can have. Because for me, it's not that week. It's the week after. It's like day 4, day 5 after. And I have a lot of ladies message me same thing. They're like, okay, Dory, so I don't tell anybody this, but this is every month, dude. Like, I fall off every month. It's, you know, day 4 after, and then I'm craving, and then I turn into a carb monster. So as soon as we have it, does that bring it right back, or do we get some protection because we're keto?
The stall that you're experiencing is only fluid shifts. You're not actually gaining any weight. And so if the scale's up and down a pound, that's just fluid. And I know it's easy for a guy to sit here and say, oh, it's just fluid, don't worry about it. And you guys are like, yeah, but it's my damn scale.
It's mine.
It's me. But I understand that. And I saw Keto Aid just said, throw the scale away. Just throw it away. And so, yeah, maybe that, but definitely during that week and the week of and the week after, you need to have some delicious high chocolate, high fat bombs. That'll just make it better. And then you'll know that next week you'll be right back on your weight loss journey, and it's going to be fine. And that's why a hubby loses weight faster than you, but it doesn't mean you can't meet your goal. It just means it takes a little longer. That's why women are so wise and so intelligent, because you guys have to put up more shit.
Yes. And for me, I find when my scale doesn't move, my body shifts. You know, things adjust, my skin's pulling in, things are tightening. My scale might not move, but I'll go down another pant size. Right now, I'm not going to lie, my scale says I'm up. It still says I'm up that 8 pounds. I'm ignoring it. I'm ignoring it because I'm down another pant size. So,
but the clothes are all fitting just fine, right?
They fit even better. I'm down another pant size. I'm from a 7, from a 9 to a 7 now, and from a medium to a small top. So I'm like,
nice.
Pshaw. So we got some really good questions on my public page as well.
Okay.
Christy Kelly Slater Salter says she's freezing and she has none of this energy that everybody else talks about that she sees me bouncing around with, and she's got zero, Dr. Ken. So what's her deal?
So almost without a doubt, the combination of cold feet, cold hands, and no energy is an iodine deficiency.
Okay.
Almost without a doubt. She can get some Lugol's 2% iodine solution.
Okay.
Off Amazon, and I think it's less than $20 for a bottle. And if you'll put two drops in your liquid each morning, it can be in your tea, your coffee, in your water, whatever. Or you can put it in your eggs if you're going to make eggs or whatever. You can put it in food. It's fine. But some people in water, they can taste it.
Okay.
But I can't. Nisha can, man. She can tell if I put one drop in her water. She's like the princess in the pea, man.
She can,
like,
smell it.
There's a
nice
pea in here. I can taste it. Yeah. And so I have to mix it in with other stuff for her. But some people can't stand it with water, but I don't taste it. I can do two drops almost on my tongue, and it doesn't bother me. I wouldn't recommend that. It might stain your teeth, because it's pretty stainy. Like, it'll stain the countertop and stuff. But it's full of iodine, which your thyroid and the rest of your body needs for proper function. And it'll boost that metabolism up so that your fingers and toes are not cold all the time.
Awesome. Now, this one's a good question, and it's something I kind of almost, I had a hard time with myself in the beginning. So, I've searched for information about night eating. My husband's 46 years old, 180, 190, 6'2", and he's been doing this all his life. He's been keto since August, and since adding intermittent fasting, it seems to have gotten worse. Prior to keto, he had major blood sugar dips. Now all of that has balanced out, but his nighttime eating is more frequent and more voracious. For example, last night he woke at midnight from hunger, although he ate plenty at dinner. Trying to stay keto, he's had an entire bag of pork rinds, an entire block of cream cheese. This unwanted interruption to his sleep is making him tired. He wants to maybe up his fat a bit to get a better night's sleep, but I'm an information junkie and I can't find anyone talking about this, writing about this, or studying about this. And perhaps you can make a video, Dr. Ken?
Yeah, that's a great idea. I actually have this same thing. It's not nearly as bad now since I've been a carnivore, but back when I still had carb-loving bacteria in my gut, like at 8 or 9 p.m., I would be in the kitchen like a carb zombie looking for carbs, right? And it was my gut bacteria saying, hey, dude, feed us some carbs. And they can actually release enzymes and chemicals in your body that cross the blood-brain barrier that can almost literally turn you into a carb zombie and make you think you're hungry when you're really not hungry. And so two things for him. He might want to go carnivore for 2 to 4 weeks.
Okay.
Pure protein and fat, zero carb, and that will kill any remaining carb-loving bacteria in your gut. That helped me a lot. Secondly, eat more fat for dinner. That's going to help because then you don't have the hunger. You might still have the craving, but it's much easier to say no to a craving if you're not also hungry at the same time, because you can't say no to hunger and craving at the same time.
No.
But add more fat at dinner and consider a 2 to 4 week trial of going carnivore. I don't think that you should be a carnivore forever, but I think 2 to 4 weeks for many, many people shakes their system up enough, and it's obviously perfectly healthy because our ancestors have been eating carnivore for hundreds of thousands of years. I don't think it's dangerous, although I'm sure there are doctors out there that will say it is. That's dumb. But I don't recommend you do it permanently. Some people are, but I don't recommend that. Just do it for 2 weeks and see if it doesn't help that, and then add more fat at dinner.
Okay. And for me, I just took into account that I'm an evening eater in my eating window, and instead of starting my eating earlier in the day, I don't even have my first meal until 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So my eating window is 3 to 11. So, hello, lovely! My darling. Look, I redid my hair today. It's still wet.
I like it.
So for me, I just...
You guys something. This is National Nurses Week in the U.S.
Oh.
And this is my nurse.
That's right? The best nurse in all of the U.S. of America. I'm just saying that.
And check out her blog and her vlog. Oh. And she's got a Facebook page. And she's also a labor delivery nurse. How awesome, right?
Yes. If you have time on Wednesday, darling, I'm doing a celebration. It's 6 whole months that I've been doing keto coaching. Can you believe it? 6 months. So if you have time, let me know on Wednesday if you want to pop by, and we'll celebrate your week and my 6 months. We'll have cake. And lights, of course, darling. Cake and lights. You can't say no.
Okay, there you go. Nisha Berry.
Excellent. We adore the Nisha. So then I had one question. A lady commented in my group, she watched your video about supplements, and she went out and she bought everything you said, and now she's like, holy man, that's a lot of stuff. What do I really need?
There's not a lot. There's only 7, and she may not even need all of them.
Okay. So, and I told her it kind of varies a little depending, right? Yeah. So what are the basics, like bare minimum basics we need, maybe not because we're keto, but just because we're lacking that already?
So most Americans and most Canadians are deficient in vitamin D.
Okay.
Are deficient in magnesium.
Okay.
And are borderline deficient in potassium, right?
Okay.
So that's why we all learn about that when we first come to this way of eating. And that's why a lot of people think they have to keep supplementing forever with those things. But as you eat better and better quality keto, you eventually don't have to. Now, in Canada, you may have to always supplement vitamin D because you guys are so far north latitude-wise, right? Yeah, I mean, what, for 1 month a year, you guys get a lot of sun, right? I don't know.
Well, we get a little bit more than that depending on the winter. And I won't lie, I don't take any, but I eat a lot of vitamin D rich foods. A lot of, you know, the spinach, the really green vegetables. I crave me them veggies. I got to have them every meal.
Absolutely. And as you eat more grass-fed pork and grass-fed butter and, you know, pastured chicken eggs, you get more vitamin D naturally. Yes. But most people are deficient when they come to this way, and that's why I recommend those supplements. Now, if you take a prescription medication for anything, then you need 200 milligrams of CoQ10 a day. That's one of the supplements. And then if you're taking vitamin D, a lot more people these days are taking some vitamin K2 along with it. Okay. That's another one that you can consider. But you have vitamin K and vitamin D and all these fatty, real grass-fed cuts of fatty meat. Yes. They have vitamin D and vitamin K2. And so as you eat better and better keto, you won't need to take all these supplements forever. Those are just temporary.
Okay. And that's the same with our collagen and stuff like that too, right? We can get that naturally.
Any collagen or any protein powder whatsoever. Think about it. If you're eating meat, you're getting all the protein and collagen you need. If you're eating chicken, you need to be eating the skin because that's collagen. Yes. You need to be eating the cartilage at the end of the bone. That's collagen, right? You need to be eating the gristle, the tendon. If you're eating a steak, you need to be eating the fat and the gristle. Those are good things for you. Don't throw those away. So many people leave the gristle and leave the skin and then take a collagen supplement. It's like, dude, stop wasting your money. Just eat the skin and eat the gristle. That's collagen.
Yes.
Right? And so many of these things we get from our diet, but we haven't eaten that way in so long that we forgot. It's like, oh yeah, eat the skin. I've been told not to eat the skin for so long that it's just a habit to not eat the skin off a chicken leg. But that's where all the collagen and a lot of the fat is. Eat the skin. Eat the cartilage. Eat the sinew. Eat the tendon. Eat the gristle. All that stuff is edible and good for your joints.
So I'm kind of greedy, and when we get like a rotisserie chicken or roast chicken, I scoop off all the skin, and then what I do is I put it in between two pieces of parchment paper, squished between two plates, I season that up, I put it in the microwave for 5 minutes, and it makes me chicken skin crisps, and then I hog that all. I'm like, man.
Oh, good. Yeah, it's just like, don't touch my skin.
Don't touch my skin. Don't even look at my skin. That's mine. Yeah, I save it. I won't lie. I save it and I hoard it like I do my bacon fat. Meh, precious.
I love it.
my favorite. So now, I got an awesome question as well about the different kinds of fasting, because they're not all the same, right? So what's intermittent fasting and what's OMAD and what's the difference between them?
Between OMAD and what?
Intermittent fasting.
So OMAD is just a form of intermittent fasting. So when you first come to keto, you fast when you sleep, right?
Okay.
So we say you sleep 8 hours. So you're fasting 8 hours. And so then when you learn about the power of intermittent fasting, you're like, hey, I want to do that. And so you start adding an hour to each side of your sleep fast and increasing your fasting window until you've got it up to a 16-hour fast, an 18-hour fast, or even a 20-hour fast. And that's what I normally do most days is a 4 to 5 hour feeding window. So I do a 20, 21 hour fast every day, or 19, 20 hours. That's what I do every day. And so I either eat, shut up, Jimmy Moore, that Dory's saving, she's going to start a Kickstarter so I can have a disco ball too.
That's right. Whoa. Everybody wants one.
You're going to put on the music and shake her booty in just a minute. Stay tuned.
That's right.
There it is. So one meal a day is just a form of intermittent fasting. That's what it is. And so as you get better at this, as you get more fat adapted, and as you get used to this way of eating, and you're eating enough fat, you're not as hungry. And so one way we talked about earlier how you know you're fat adapted is when you forget to eat. When you look up and it's 2 p.m., you're like, shit, I forgot to eat lunch.
Yes.
You're fat adapted and you're getting enough fat in your diet, because, and that way you're not constantly hungry and hangry like you used to be back when you were eating your old crappy diet, right?
Yes.
So that's what one meal a day is OMAD, is just a 22 or a 23-hour fast. And some people call it a once-a-day or a 24-hour fast, but I don't think technically it is. I think it's a 22, 23-hour fast, because when I eat, honey, I eat for a minute.
Right? Yes.
And by a minute, I mean an hour or two.
That's right, or two or three or four.
When I'm done, I don't need any more. But that's what it is. And so all you guys out there, be reading about intermittent fasting, but don't start with it. Get your keto under your belt. learn the ropes, and then you can start adding some intermittent fasting.
Yes, and then I have one last question, and then we'll dance out. But my question is about extended fasting. Now, what should that look like, Dr. Ken? Should it be like, oh, I'm not really hungry to eat yet, I don't feel like it? Or should you be looking at your clock going, okay, it's only 48 hours, and I promised myself 62. I can suffer through this. I can suffer. I can starve. I can get through it. Or should we just be listening to when our body wants to eat?
It can be either or.
Okay.
And now Jimmy Moore, he was just watching. He is a leading expert on fasting. Like, he'll knock off a 7-day fast with just a water fast, water and salt, 7 days. He's done it multiple times. And so he's also a wealth of information. I think he's living La Vida Low Carb or Living Low Carb Man or something like that.
Yeah, I think it's comment something again, like Jimmy, that, yeah.
Here so everybody can see your handle. I can't remember exactly what it is. But he is an expert on fasting. He kind of wrote the book.
Yeah, he's speaking at KetoCon too.
I went longer than 24 hours. I was so fat adapted that I just wasn't hungry. And so I got home, I was going to eat, and I was like, you know what? No, I'm not going to eat. I'm not going to eat. And so I just went to bed. I was like a bad boy. I got sent to bed without supper.
No dinner.
And so then I didn't eat until the next day after lunch. And so I went 40 hours, I think. And it was effortless because I just wasn't hungry when it came time for me to eat.
Yes. Excellent. Well, that is definitely what we're looking for today. Let me turn down this on the commercial, and then we will dance out, and we'll see you again next week. As always, it is so amazing to hang out with you. You're my favorite. I don't mean to, you know, I shouldn't pick favorites. I really shouldn't, but you're my favorite doctor, just saying.
Thank you so much, Dory. I'll see you next time.
Yes. Have yourself a great week, Dr. Ken, and kisses for the Nisha.
See you later.
Bye, darling. Thanks so much for hanging out with us today, guys.